So, some of the things you need to think about in bringing your brand overseas. One of the first things, obviously, is think about what is the national brand of your country, in this case, Ecuador. What is the imagen país of Ecuador in the market you're thinking about going to? That's a very important thing, because if the brand image of the country is weak or is negative, you might not want to promote yourself as an Ecuadorian company. Depending upon what you're selling, perhaps you're selling agricultural products, where the flowers, perhaps, where Ecuador would have a very strong national brand image for that product. So think about your sector, think about the market you want to go into, and try to understand what impressions, what ideas your target market in that country has about your own country. That's very important to do. It's not hard to do. A simple study will tell you that. Obviously, you need to understand the regulatory environment, because some markets, you may find that you really want to enter China with your product. But I found this in one example with one of my clients. They want a national license to sell banking products in China. That was a big deal. We have a national license. It took me years to get that license. But I'm not allowed to sell anywhere until I get provincial license and municipal licenses. And so you may find that the product you want to sell is not allowed or has certain restrictions in that market. Obviously, you need to know that. Every country that you are seriously considering entering, you should register your brand, register your trademark. Protect your brand before someone else takes it. It's a pain in the neck to do. It takes a long time to do. You need to involve lawyers, but it's well worth the investment, because if you decide you want to enter the Mexican market and you find that there's a company that's already got your brand name, it's going to be a lot more expensive to change your brand for that market than to protect it before you enter. Obviously, how you enter the market makes a difference, whether you're going in from zero in a green field, whether you're acquiring a company that's already existing, or whether you use a joint venture. And each one of these will impact what you say about yourself and how the brand has to change. Maybe you go in a joint venture and you don't use your brand at all. That's an example of what Nokia did in the United States in the early 1990s. They didn't go in as Nokia. They went in using the brand of the telephone companies. And later, after the market began to see that these telephone companies were offering phones that were better quality, only later did they begin to launch their brand and their name into the market. Obviously, you want to know who your interest groups are. You want to map those. You want to do a lot of investigation, a lot of research. You want to think about what does your name say in that market. We had a very hard time in China at New York Life registering the name New York Life, because the authorities said you can't register a trademark that's a lifestyle. The way people live in New York is not a product. We had to explain to them that no, life in this case is short for life insurance. It doesn't mean life as in living. So you have to think about the language. And you have to think about, how do my future clients like to get their information? Are they readers, or do they watch television more, or do they admire sports figures? In India, if your brand is not promoted by a cricket player, a sports figure, you're nothing. You have to have celebrities backing you. It's a big deal in certain markets. So figure out how your potential target market likes to get its information. Who do they look to validate their beliefs? Okay, I'll talk quickly about the national brand image, because it's a little bit complicated, but it's very, very important. So ask yourself, what does the brand of your market, your country, say about your potential product? This is, in my opinion, perhaps the strongest brand in the entire world is this right here. It says something immediately. What do we think? Generally, we think of mountains, beautiful nature, maybe funny-looking men with watches. But we also think about products. If we hear that something is made in Switzerland, the idea that it doesn't work well is incomprehensible. That shows you the power of this brand right here. The other way around, so this is an example of the national brand giving its attributes to the products. There's another example, I mentioned earlier, Nokia, which has done the reverse. This company, through being an excellent, or it's having difficulties now, but through its history of technology and innovation, has helped Finland become better known as a country. So sometimes a company can reinforce the national brand as well. People now think of Finland as a high technology country, a country that invests a lot in education, and much of that is thanks to the, much of that is thanks to what Nokia did in terms of improving the national brand. So, it's the responsibility, it's not your responsibility as entrepreneurs, it's the responsibility of the government to do what is to find out what people think about products, a variety of products from your country, and do what's necessary to enhance the brand and build the brand. So you need to think about, as Ecuadorian companies, you need to think about what does brand Ecuador say about my product or my sector. If it doesn't say anything good, you don't want to focus on Ecuador as the market. If it does say something, if what you're selling is lifestyle or nature or agricultural products or anything having to do with tourism, it could say a lot. But you need to investigate that. You need to find out, for whatever new market you're going to, what does my national brand say about my product and my sector? I'm going to talk a little bit about research. This may be basic for many of you, but let's just take a minute to review it. There are lots of types of research, and research is fundamental, absolutely fundamental. I can't tell you the number of clients I have who want to launch a communications program without doing the research. Companies might be willing to spend $200,000, $300,000 on an advertising campaign, but are reluctant to spend $10,000 to do the research necessary to make sure that their message will resonate. And that's something that really needs to change. We all, if we're thinking about branding and we're thinking about communicating, it has to be based on investigation, on research. So what do you want to look for when you're doing branding research, international branding research? Obviously, you want to see which of your many attributes, and remember, you'll have done the work to find out what those attributes are, which of the many attributes of your company are going to be well received by the target. What are the national stereotypes? Not just about your country, but what are the national stereotypes you have to deal with in your new market? How do I reach the leaders of opinion? How do I reach the influencers? Because we all, every one of us, we make our consumer decisions based on influencers. It may be people we trust who live next door. It may be a sports figure. It may be Madonna. I don't know. We make our decisions, almost all of us make our decisions based on the influence of someone else. Who are, in each market, who are the influencers? What types of people are leaders of opinion? And how do I reach them? How do I communicate to them? Similarly, how do people consume media? What is the language need to, what are the language issues? Particularly in naming, you need to make sure that your name does not have negative connotations in the new market. Very important to do, very easy to research, but a lot of people don't take the time to do that. Visual elements, colors. What does your color say about you? In the Chinese markets, the color blue, a bright blue, is what is worn at funerals. So it's associated with death. So if you're a company selling life insurance and your logo is blue, like the company I used to work for, you've got a big, big problem. So you have to come around, you either change your logo or you slowly start to educate the populace. I'm not going to go into these. These are just very many different types of research that you can do. And these are some of the things you want to think about. You want to make sure that your values are well defined before you do research. If you don't know what you stand for, research won't tell you very much. We want to establish a baseline. The baseline will have a number of elements. One of them is defining your target market. If you enter the United States market, you're not trying to sell to 300 million people. You're trying to sell to a very small segment of that. That's your target audience. How do you define your target audience? Where do they live? How do you find them? That's a very important thing you have to do. Here's a good example. In India, a country of, what is it now, 1.2 billion people, I think? Anyway, more than 1 billion people. Huge market. Only about 6 or 7 million people have credit cards. So that tells you that when you go to India, if we're selling a product that has some value added to it, we're not selling to 1.2 billion people. We're selling to 5, 6, 7, 10 million people. That's targeting. That's targeting, your finding out what your target market is. And you want to find out what are the aspirations, what are the goals and beliefs of your target market. Because when you have that information, you can tailor your message to them. I always say that you want to try, whatever you're researching, you want to boil it down into numbers. Because when you have numbers, you can measure that year after year against that benchmark, and you can see improvement in what you're doing. Sometimes marketers and people who work in communications don't take the effort to translate their findings into strong numbers. It's very important to do. And finally, you want to verify every year or 2 years against your baseline. Make sure that you're making progress. And if you're not making progress, you need to stop and ask yourself why. And finally, what's the methodology we should use? There are many methodologies in research. I'm just putting here the most basic ones. Qualitative research is where you get the most information. You want to make sure you're doing it well. Generally, focus groups are the way people do qualitative surveys. That's where you're going to get the richest amount of information. But you have to make sure that you're doing it properly, you're not biasing or influencing the respondents in a way. But that's where you discover most, or you can do one-on-one in-depth interviews, 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes. You're going to learn a lot of rich information, and you're going to take that information, and you're going to validate it with a quantitative survey, a much larger survey. It can be done by telephone, or on the internet, or by mail, or intercept interviews, which are face-to-face brief interviews in a mall or on a street corner. This is very basic. Obviously, research professionals have much more methodologies to choose from. But these are the types of things you want to think about as you're planning a research campaign. I want to get deep information in my qualitative, and I want to validate it with quantitative. And this is not expensive. It's not expensive. If you're thinking of spending money to enter into a new market, take the time and spend the money necessary to do the research. Right. You will, in the long run, save money. Now, I told you that brands have to change, have to modify with every market, just a little bit, sometimes a lot. Here are some visual examples. At New York Life, in the Chinese markets, and in certain other markets, we had to put the translation. Because this means, to someone in China, this means nothing, whereas this means what this means. So you have to go to that effort. It's kind of hard to see, but Coca-Cola, in each of their markets, it's a slightly different, each of their languages is a slightly different element. But they preserve some of these. Look at the curly Q there, and look at the curl on the K there. HSBC, wonderful branding here. This is called a serif. This is a type of a typographical element. You've got serifs here. In the Chinese, they put serifs as well, because it gives some of the same. What these serifs say to the consumer is solidity. I've been around for a long time. It's old. So you can capture that in the other language. These are some of the little visual details that these brands have thought about in different markets. And even the weighting and the heaviness of the letters. We chose characters that had a similar flow in Chinese to what we see here in the Roman characters. And then finally, you need to put it all together. You need to communicate your brand. And how do you do that? Well, it's pretty much self-evident, but you want to begin Your plan of communication has to begin with understanding your market. Has to know how can you communicate to your potential clients if you don't know how they like to receive information. In a minute, I'm going to show you a good example of this. Where do you want to put your effort? Where are you going to put your dollars? Remember, you're not communicating to 300 million residents of the United States. You're communicating to a very small element of that market. Where are you going to focus your efforts? But wherever you focus, you want to communicate deliberately. Think about it. So many companies just communicate, oh, I have an opportunity to put an ad in this newspaper because the salesman called me. Let me think about that. That's not communication, that's reactive. Take the time to be deliberate and communicate continuously. I can't tell you how many clients have come to me and said, I have a chance, I want to spend $30,000 on this ad, but that's the only ad I'm going to do all year in one magazine. Well, I'd much rather you take that $30,000 and focus it month after month on a smaller group so that that group understands you, rather than spending $30,000 for a one-time advertisement that may or may not be seen by people. It's better to spend less but consistently over a long time than to spend a lot one time. And take the time and effort to communicate to your employees and to the family members of your employees and to the neighbors of your employees. Focus on your employees. Communicate to your employees first. Turn your employees into brand champions and they will spread the brand for you. Here's a wonderful example of this. The Facebook page of Coca-Cola is not property of Coca-Cola. It's some guy in Los Angeles who loves Coca-Cola, and he set up a Facebook page. And the Facebook page for Coca-Cola, I don't know how many millions of fans they have, but what Coca-Cola has done is they have so much confidence in their brand that they're willing to let their brand become the property of someone else. You don't have lawyers calling this guy up every day saying, stop using the Coca-Cola name on your Facebook page. That's our property. They have said, no. We trust, our brand is so strong and so well known and so well communicated that we trust our employees and our consumers to do the work for us. So turn your employees into brand champions. Make sure they know what the brand says, what your company promises, and let them tell other people for you. That's the best investment you can make in your communications. And then you want to integrate your communications. Think about the various tools you can use and take those messages and replicate them through different vehicles. I'll show you an example of that in a minute. Here's a perfect example of what you need to think about in a new market. Hong Kong has about 6 million people, maybe 7, about the same population as New York. New York City has, if I'm not mistaken, has 5 daily newspapers in New York City. Hong Kong has 25 daily newspapers. Last time, it may have changed in the past few years, but when I was working there, 25 daily newspapers, some in English, most of them in Chinese. So that tells you something about the market. It tells you that they read a lot. And so you really need to think about, okay, my target customers, what are they reading? Which of these papers are they reading? And that will define, that will help me figure out where I put my message. Just a brief example that I like about thinking about communications planning. Think of it as circular. Don't think of it as a line. Think of it as something that begins with investigation, research, goes to aligning message implementing, evaluating, measuring. You're constantly changing, you're constantly thinking, you're constantly researching the market and adjusting your communications to that market. And finally, a quick word about integrated communications. These are the general tools that companies have to manage their communications. Whether you're a small company may not use all of these, but for the most part, these are the things you need to think about. You have here one of your most powerful tools, internal communications. Research is something every company needs to be doing. Advertising and sponsorship may not be something for you, but it's one of the possible tools. Obviously, you want to make sure that your executives are good communicators and understand the message as well. So these are just some examples, but the idea behind this is you want to make sure your message, the attributes that you're communicating, are replicated along as many channels as possible. And that doesn't mean that you necessarily are spending a lot of money, but it means you are being deliberate and consistent in your communication. So I'm going to leave you with this final thought about communications and branding. And communications is not about printing catalogs or advertising, doing an advertising spot. Communications is about constructing strong relations with every one of your interest groups. And you want to do that through consistent, deliberate communications over time. And it takes a long time to do, but it has to be deliberate. And it has to be something that you're thinking carefully about. So many clients of mine think of communications as a tactical tool. They make a business decision and they say, oh, well, let me do an event or let me issue a press release. Communications begins before that. You need to think about what are the implications of this business decision on your brand. Will my customers accept it? Will they not? So to wrap up, here are some things to remember when thinking about taking your brand overseas. One of the most valuable assets of any company is its brand. When you realize that for many companies, their major asset is their brand, that will change how you think about taking your brand overseas. Figure out what your imagen país, what your national brand says about your product, and whether that is received well, depending upon your sector, in the new market. Make sure that you understand your own brand yourself. Take the time to study what your brand says about your company, whether your promise is well articulated. Do that before you try to explain your brand in another language, in another culture. And understand which of your brand attributes are going to be most widely accepted and understood in the new market. This is obvious. You don't want to begin your communications until you've done your investigation of the market. You want to make sure you understand the regulatory environment. You want to make sure that your communications plan is deliberate and consistent. You absolutely want to communicate to your employees. And finally, you want to think about, am I using all of the tools available and am I using them consistently to communicate my message? I want to leave you with one final image that I like. I think it's kind of funny. This is something that would have given a heart attack to my bosses in New York, my corporate, very formal bosses, if they had seen their logo riding on an elephant. That's the sort of thing that's just forbidden. But I know that India is a market where there's not a lot of readership of magazines and newspapers. There's not many of our target households didn't have televisions. I know that religion and religious festivals are very important in India. And I know that the elephant has a huge symbolism in India. So when I saw this, when one of the people who worked for me in India sent me this image, at first I was taken aback. But I realized, well, wait a minute. It's responding to the target market. And you need to think about, it may seem ridiculous to me as a North American or as an Ecuadorian, you may think positioning your brand in China in one way is ridiculous, but you have to put yourself in the shoes of the customers there. And this, to me, I think shows the challenges and the opportunities you have and that your brand will face when it goes overseas to a new market. So that's it. That's my presentation. Thank you very much. And any questions you may have.
How do you register a mark globally?
a brand globally. There are law firms that specialize in this. I know one in Quito that I've been working with that does just this, Bass Horowitz. They have a specialty in trademark law. But you want to find a trademark lawyer, people who know, who understand the difficulties in every country. And your trademark lawyer here may not know the rules for each country, but generally they will have associates, affiliates in other countries who can tell them. But what you want to do is you want to think, okay, in the next 5 years, 10 years, what are the possible markets I'm going to go into? You want to start early. One of my jobs was to work with the lawyers to register the brands. And we picked countries that seemed probable, even though we didn't yet have a plan to enter that market definitively. We had an idea that maybe we would. Once you have the idea and you say, I might be entering Panama in the next 5 years, ask your lawyers to research the steps, what are the rules for entering, how much is it going to cost. And you also want to reserve the website too. Very important to protect the website. So if it's Panama, you want to, whatever your website is, .. what are the initials for Panama? PN, I don't know. Or in Ecuador, .EC. Make sure you reserve those. It's very inexpensive to do. I think it costs $15 to register that the website domain. But try to think several years beforehand, because if you don't, you might find yourself up against a wall. And then big companies often pay a lot of money to buy the name of an existing company if they've taken the name. Sí.
Señor Lucuy, usted mencionó dos preguntas. Una, usted mencionó que la estrategia de marca va anterior a todas las actividades de la empresa, no solo que parte del marketing, sino todas.
Sí.
Entonces, le pedí un ejemplo práctico de cómo la estrategia de marca incluye, por ejemplo, en la producción de una empresa. Un ejemplo. Segundo, ¿bajo qué condiciones una marca puede ser usada, una marca paraguas, para otra? ¿Bajo qué condiciones es eficiente usar una marca como marca paraguas para otra? ¿Bajo qué condiciones no?
Obviously, there's a lot of different. In these two questions you have, it depends a lot on what sector you're working in, what type of business you have. I'll give you an example of the first one, how it can influence production. Mercedes-Benz, we think of them as having very expensive automobiles. But Mercedes-Benz in Europe makes something called the smart car, which is very, very small, very inexpensive. And how does that influence production? Well, Mercedes-Benz will never, as far as I can tell, will never put their logo and their name on the smart car, because it's two products that are very, very different. Mercedes-Benz decided to do that because they saw an opportunity in the ultra-small car market. Inexpensive but well-designed cars. So they used their production expertise, their engineering, to produce a very well-designed car. But it was too inexpensive for Mercedes-Benz. It was too small for Mercedes-Benz, so they put a different brand on it. And that's an example of how the production of a brand, you can see that they decided, we're not going to build a tiny Mercedes-Benz, we're going to build something else and call it something else. So that's one example. The second question was the umbrella brand. I've recently been advising a client here in the region about how to create an umbrella brand in their business. And their business, again, it's the automobile business, but they're selling cars. And trying to create an umbrella brand when you have very different products is incredibly difficult. And I would advise against it for most companies. I advise against it. In this instance, with automobile dealerships, it can work. I have seen examples in the United States, Chile, in other countries, of a company that sells in one building, it'll sell BMW, in another building, it'll sell Toyota, in another building, it'll sell Volkswagen. But But each one of those cars says something very different to its customers. So even though the example that's coming to mind is a company, a dealership in Washington called Koons, and they started out as a Ford dealership, focusing on the broad middle market. Then they went to Koons BMW. Then they went to Koons, I forget the other one. It's another foreign brand I wanted to say. Saab, I think Saab, I'm not sure. But what they're trying to say is trust Koons more than the brand that I'm selling. That's a very hard thing to do. Yes, you can do it, but it's hard. And the main thing you have to do is make sure your service level is equal. So the service that a customer gets in the BMW dealership under the umbrella brand has to be exactly the same level of service that they give in the Ford dealership under that umbrella brand. And that's very hard to do. Very hard. It takes a lot of investment and a lot of training. And it's even harder if, like many companies here in Latin America, in the region, if I sell toothpaste and I sell motorcycles and I sell women's clothing, an umbrella brand for that is almost impossible. Yes, sir.
Comentar sobre la misma, por favor.
I generally don't want to comment without having done the research. So I'll just give you some basic generalizations as me personally, not having to do with any research. I would say in certain countries, Ecuador has a more difficult marca país than in others. I would think in your immediate neighbors, Colombia, Peru, you might have a difficult time selling more sophisticated engineered products. For example, financial services, I don't think it makes sense for a financial, and I have a client, a financial services client in Quito who wants to enter into Colombia. But doing so under their brand, which is very identified with Ecuador, would not be a good idea. This client said to me that they have a hard time convincing people in Bogota or in Sao Paulo that they really know investment banking well because of where they're based. I also heard from a company that produces engineered products that had a difficult time selling in Peru. They had to take off the label that said made in Ecuador. They took it off their boxes. They're doing quite well in Peru now, but they're selling it as a Peruvian product, not as an Ecuadorian product. In other areas, particularly agricultural products, in Europe, it could be a very positive thing. Ecuadorian chocolate in Europe is prized. And I think, frankly, the cacao producers here are not doing enough to label their product as being from Ecuador. Flowers, same thing, they're not doing enough. I think they could take a lot more advantage of the marca país of Ecuador. Some countries it's harder than others. I think right now the United States could be a difficult place in certain markets for Ecuadorian products. You want to think about markets where there are a lot of Ecuadorian immigrants. That could be positive, that could be negative. You need to do the research on that. I would say generally speaking, the marca país of Ecuador is neutral. It's not negative. You're not dealing with something like China, which has, in most products, a relatively negative attribute, or a country like, it's difficult to generalize, but Ecuador is not in the situation, I would think, of a country like Indonesia or the Philippines, where there are some well-known negative attributes. Ecuador has a neutral marca país. Which is good. That means there's room to grow. But it will differ significantly sector to sector. So analyze the sector.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm happy to answer questions afterwards.
One more.
¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Como usted sabe, cuando hay una marca, hay un genérico. ¿Correcto? Entonces, una vez que yo he realizado todo el estudio y todo el trabajo para poner mi marca en mi país para poderla internacionalizar, me encuentro de que tengo una copia, tengo una invitación. Le pregunto, ¿qué debo hacer en ese caso? Gracias.
Well, there's a saying in English, I don't know if you have it in Spanish as well, that imitation is the highest form of flattery. So you should be happy that they're imitating. That means that there's something good about your product that they're imitating. It's very, very hard, and the pharmaceutical industry is really facing this right now. How do I distinguish myself from my imitators and my competitors? The only way is to go back to that circle of innovation that I showed you. You have to distinguish yourself from your competitors by showing that you have better attributes to your brand, that your product is a little bit better. Think of the perfume. Is Chanel No. 5 really that much better than some other perfume that has the same characteristics? Probably not. But over time, over years, Chanel has communicated their attributes to their market again and again and again, such that it becomes almost natural to us to think that the product is slightly better, or I know it, so I'm not going to risk the other that I don't know. So unfortunately, if you're in an industry where there's a lot of imitations, the answer really is you have to spend more to distinguish yourself. You have to spend more so you can charge more. It's difficult, I don't like having to say that, but that's really the only way around it. You have to build your brand and your attributes. So whether that spending is going into communicating or whether it's going into research and development, it doesn't really matter, but you have to spend more. So by spending more, you are allowed to charge more, usually. Obviously, competitive pressures differ from market to market. But the best way to combat imitations and knockoffs and generics is to do exactly what the drug companies are doing, which is to spend more on communications and spend more on research and development. One more.
¿Puede ampliar los términos patentes de invención, modelos de utilidad y diseño industrial que son registrados?
Repite, por favor, repite. Los términos son
patente de invención, modelos, diseño industrial y modelo de utilidad.
Are those terms that I use? Son términos que yo